I'm happy to introduce you to our last and final speaker, Rozana Montiel, the founder and director of the Mexico-based firm Rozana Montiel, Estudio de Arquitectura. She is speaking with us today from, I assume, Mexico City, Mexico, where her firm is based. She's won several national and international awards, including being selected for the Rockefeller Foundation Residency of Artistic Research. Her work, Sand Ground, was presented at the International Architecture Exhibition of the 2018 Venice Biennale Free Space. I'm excited to hear her speak today about her design process, research, and experimentation. So if you please take the stage, Rozana Montiel.
Hello. Thank you very much, Lenny, for presenting me. And thank you, Selma, for the invitation to this Design with Vision conferences. I'm very excited to present my work. And unfortunately, we were not able to meet in March, but we're now virtually doing it. And I hope that soon we could meet somewhere. So I'm going to start my presentation here. Perfect. So I would like to start telling you about where I come from. So this is Mexico City. It's the place where I live, where I work. By 2050, it is expected to be the seventh largest economy. Mexico City has around 22 million people. And well, obviously it is a place of unbelievable contrasts. By the way, this is not Photoshop, but reality. It's amazing how things work here in a best way or the other. It is also a place of incredible fluidity and invention. Its people are constantly stuck in a race against time, as you can see here, the subway stations, where resource scarcity and waste are equally large. But it's a place where it offers living opportunities to many. The people drawn to urban peripheries colonize farmland for urban purposes. The periphery is open to informality and therefore more fluid in its infrastructure and solutions, but it is also farther away from urban centers and lack adequate mobility. So mega cities like mine raise daily important questions. In a world of limited time and resources, what is absolutely urgent and necessary to design? Also, what type of architecture can we sustain worldwide for a new vision? How can we solve important issues with the minimum possible infrastructure? So I believe the vision of architecture now is positioned to sustain better living conditions by reorganizing the urban fabric, designing flexible systems, redistributing wealth and resources, increasing time efficiency, reducing environmental impact, influencing institutional lifestyles and technology. But most of us were not taught architecture this way, or not in Mexico City when I studied architecture. Architectural design has become a form of strategic thinking capable of solving complex urban problems creatively with a minimum of resources. So I sustain a vision of place. Placemaking is a powerful approach to spatial production that enhances quality of life and interconnects people. Placemaking is not a design product, but a designing process. My studio research has focused on learning from the city itself by observing patterns of objects along the city and keeping a register of diverse informal typologies by experimenting with materials and resignifying their uses. We constantly redraw because it is a way of looking closer at the real, of picking up details that are crucial in transforming reality. This is the wall of the office. For us, representation in architectural design is not only a medium of conveying meaningful narratives of space, but also resignifying our connections to space. Therefore, mediums of representation are integral to the design process and inseparable from the translation of an idea into any concrete form. We made a book called Common Spaces in Social Housing Units. It was published as part of our piece in the Venice Biennale in 2018. And what it the book does, it reworks with typographical arrangements and the post-it format as a methodology. So we have redrawn and drawn more than 400 of these pink small post-its called graphic aphorisms, where it shows observations of what we do, but it also shows ideas of new projects. So they are paired to maxims, which are sentences, very small sentences with common sense, that are this series of observations, as I said before, and design solutions for public space development. The aim of this book is compiling a series of principles and effective tactics that free and activate a process of placemaking. This is how we design it. So we work creating typography. How can we create space with typography? How can we design in different ways of looking, which for me, that's a new way of having a different vision. So we designed these type of books to think and research new languages of the architectural practice itself. So as I said before, for me, architecture is not only looking through the eyes. Well, I didn't say that, but it's also looking through the skin with a haptic vision. With this idea, vision is not only the ability to see, obviously, but it's also something that you can imagine. And that's how we work in the office. We're always imagining, having the vision of our projects, and by redrawing them, by creating new ways of representation, and also imagining different futures. We, in the office, we work in different scales and layers. We also work with social projects, private projects, exhibitions. We're always interested in participating in different types of exhibitions and also doing research. So in terms of representation, we achieve our visual metaphors through a play on scales and layers that prove new ways of looking at the architectural object. Our models involve the viewer's active way of seeing and imaginative capabilities. For instance, we presented this optic art piece as a model of how city life works with landmarks magnifying and condensing flux and exchange around themselves. So all these lenses were put together to understand different ways of looking at reality. So to start, I would like to start with this project that's called Stand Ground that was presented in the Venice Biennale in 2018, Free Space. And our piece Stand Ground sustained a position of common ground, which invited people to imagine a process. Vision is also imagining processes. So we paved the exhibition floor with a one-to-one reproduction of the Arsenal wall. On the original wall, a screen was projected in real time with the activity of public space behind the barrier. So, and this, as simply as it sounds, was incredibly hard to do because filming public spaces impinges on issues of security and privacy. So in a way, we discovered how really hard it is to remove a wall. So we were working with the idea of how to change barriers into boundaries. And we decided just to work with what we found in the context of the arsenal. So we found this wall, this old wall, brick wall, and we decided to work with that. only with the wall and the space we had. And so the interpretation, the reinterpretation of the wall communicate as a ground, communicated public space with private space. We wanted also to relate with public space. We wanted to be outside in Venice with all this plaza and public spaces. So how to introduce public space into private space? How to dissolve a barrier, this wall, to transform it into something active, into something permeable, in introducing and changing the idea of exterior to interior, open to close, and then just playing with the idea of a common ground. So we, with this, we put all the post-its in this table to show the process of how we synthesize our projects in an art exhibition or architecture exhibition, but also talks about the relation between art and architecture with this idea of stand ground. So to recall what we do in the office is that the studio has focused on architectural design, artistic resignification of space, mobility, housing, and the public domain. But design-wise, we're mostly interested in the frame that connects us. So in what follows, I will show the project that we have done in the office with a 7-point manifesto. These projects really interconnect each other, but I chose to organize them according to their prominent aspects. So this manifesto seeks content in context, change barriers into boundaries, shifts spatial perception, approaches the landscape as the program, resignifies materials, works with vision, and holds beauty as a basic right. So to start with, seek content in context. I would like to show you this first project called Boy Temple. So to understand a little what I mean seeking content in context, is that before setting out to design, thoroughly research the specific potential resources and community assets and essential needs of a site. We hire locally, we source regionally, we work with the community, not just for it. And we engage people not as consumers of space, but as place makers. So this restores citizens to cities, what is very important to us for the office. So this Boy Temple talks about place making in a way of building processes which enable meaningful connections between spaces and people. But even more so, I would say that place making is recognizing that meaningful connections lay the ground for any building process. So this should be the first assumed context for architecture's content development. Boy Temple is done in collaboration with Derek Delecamp, and it's one of the 7 landmarks in the landscape along the route of a 200-year-old pilgrimage, which annually goes across the Western Highlands of Mexico. Approximately 1 million people travel by foot 117 kilometers around springtime with Easter. This white concrete wall forming a 40 meter diameter circle, which we design, is a piece placed amidst pine woods that blend with the particular topography of the site. It informs its content with the context of a natural haven, respecting the terrain slopes and elevations. At some points, it's suspended 3 meters high, at others buried to respect horizontality. But its essential feature is to be an open boundary, an austere tectonic gesture in the landscape that marks more than a site or territory. It is an expression of timeless space. In our research, we realize the sense of timelessness evoked by historical circles of stone, and it's due to the fact that their form is not bound to any specific vital function, except perhaps the very vital one of building significant relationships. Whatever their intent, these spaces were active by the bonds and exchange which set them in place. Boy Temple includes the macrocosmos in the microcosmos. As an architect, I am careful that the effect of what we design leads to connectedness and integration. When architecture takes for granted the social ground which makes it happen, it forgets its vital effect, that is to build relationships. Relationships are the primary shelter of any society. Without them, proper shelter cannot exist. This next project we call Rooftop Court. Sometimes our approach is not seeking content in context, but actually creating a new context through our content. In recent years, I have worked on many projects for the rehabilitation of public spaces and common areas in social housing units. This is also not a Photoshop, it's reality. It's very sad how in the past 20 years we have been building these housing units. A repetition of non-places without public space, without any transportation near, with any community centers, schools, sports area. So this is how all the developers have been doing architecture in the last years. So the consequences, as you can see, have been really, really terrible. And many of them have been abandoned because of why? Because they become lifeless dormitory blocks whose social depression factors significantly in the real estate value of property. So in these developments, which evoke post-urban non-places of contextless context, the content we design creates frames for the rehabilitation of cultural context. So by activating public space effectively in housing blocks, we will be enabling a grassroots culture to emerge and shape community. We want to forget about these, that they really just think about cars and automobiles, no public space, as I said before, this repetition of generic architecture and non-places. And we work in one of these places where 25,000 inhabitants will live in the next years. So the places that you see now green will be completely full with houses that they built. For days, they built many, many of these houses. And so what they gave us, what we found in this suburban townhouse complex near the Gulf of Mexico City, this is a place called Lagos de Puente Moreno in Veracruz. They asked us to build a roof for this basketball court that you can see there. They just gave us that space, the space of the court. This Veracruz is a place where the weather is like in Miami, it's very hot almost all day. So imagine if you couldn't do anything without a roof. So they just use it sometimes at night, but it was underused the whole time. This is a place where vegetation grows exuberant and impressive. And if you can see, this space had no vegetation at all. So there was no shadow. So also the idea of a vision for me is when people or the communities ask you for something, we give them more. We as architects have the vision to giving in more. So if they ask for a roof, we ended up with a whole community center. So we planted a lot of trees that are now are really grown. So the whole place has shadows. And we decided to put usually in Mexico, they're doing these rooftops with very big columns. And so what we decided is to put very thin columns, and in the in-between space, put a whole idea of program. So we put bathrooms, we put a library, we would put classrooms, we put hammocks, swings, we put games. It became a completely agora, fulfilled with a program of a community center. So with the exact same space that they gave us, we gave them much more than they asked. And after they saw that, they gave us this area where there were no trees, so we could also use it. So we extended our structure with sports, bars, and ideas of games, with all this vegetation, with a forum. And so it became a habitable space instead of this unused area. So the portico agora created a new habitat through vegetation and expanded the user's program by the way of height and intercolumn capacity. So as I said before, in between the columns, we inserted a multifunctional program. When the developer realized the positive social impact that the place had on his social housing venture, he invited a biologist working in the natural reserve nearby to set up a herbal medicinal clinic with a small botanical garden where the community will be taught the benefits of local medicinal plants. So the healing effect of the project was immediate. We went from the contextlessness created by the generic urban sprawl of a cultural desert to a hub for ecological awareness and biodiversity preservation solely by designing a program which sustains a vision of place. So the idea of changing barriers into boundaries. A boundary is a permeable membrane that generates parity between private and public space, encourages social interaction and exchange. People will feel safer and more at home in places of open communication than in spaces of garrisoned fears. Work with people to help them voice their hopes, needs, and aspirations to overcome barriers. So this project called Common Unity was done also, it's also a rehabilitation of public space in housing units. This, you cannot see whether it's the city or whether it's a housing unit where 70,000 inhabitants live and more than 15,000 houses are built there. So these housing complexes are massive. 25% of Mexican population lives in housing units. So they are cities in their own right, as you can see. So Common Unity was an intervention we did for Infonavit in collaboration with an architect, Alin Wallach, in the San Pablo Jalpa housing unit located in the industrialized northern part of Mexico City. The unit we were given has around 7,000 inhabitants. When we arrived to Jalpa, we found a partition housing unit. Zoning and access had been altered through walls, fences, and barriers mounted by residents. The gated sectors fragmented Jalpa's landscape into passageways and corridors that push social life out of common areas. Fences had become a barrier to habitability. In some, public space was privatized, underused, or inexistent. Walls, fences, and barriers, however, were untouchable, as they had in fact solved the internal security of the unit. Jalpa had no free space for civic life, so we work around the barriers created by the residents in order to make them permeable, democratic, and meaningful. We engaged the community through several site actions and workshops. Side actions are a characteristic signature of the office work. They are very low-cost interventions that involve the people with their space in a logic, innovative way. Their purpose is to get people to voice their needs and aspirations. The added value of letting people represent their own space is they become aware of the worth of what they have. So we did all these side actions, putting these tarps, asking the people what would they like for, in a place where all these walls were put and all these fences. So this idea of changing the vertical into the horizontal was very important. So shifting the wall, shifting the fence, shifting the vertical that separates and enclosures and divides for the horizontal, a roof, a shelter, a floor that connects, reunites, and encourages community interaction. This is what we found, and we transformed the space into this. So with very simple things, the horizontal became more than just a roof again. The shelter common areas we designed expanded the program of potential activities through compact multifunctional structures that cater to all age groups around the clock. We develop integral low-cost improvement of public space by resignifying simple materials. The place can be experienced today as a system of courtyards. The flexible boundaries made the common areas more than a front yard or a park because they're private and public at the same time. Design spoke for itself in common unity. People willingly gave up 90% of the barriers. So trust was the touchstone for change. We also recycle extant spaces for cultural activity. There was an old leaky shed we called El Saloncito that was already in use as a multipurpose room for school tutoring, knitting clubs, and religious instruction. Our intervention brought out all its potential. A totally different space emerged in the same exactly place. We kept the same exact area of the old one, but the use of natural materials, open visuals, and light transformed it into a welcoming space. A bookstore donated an important collection of children's books, and the Saloncito became a library. Then a telecom company gave access to free Wi-Fi, and the surrounding area became a work hub. So we went from a gloomy shed to a sunny library study area. As of today, Jalpa is filled with life and constant community. People before didn't even know each other. Now neighbors turn turns to sweep the fallen leaves instead of felling the trees. There are outdoor classes, teaching lessons, ceremonies, movie nights. The new space facilitated a different kind of ownership and appropriation, one that habituates inhabitants to work for the common good. So for me also, vision is a social vision, changing perception of people of their own spaces through placemaking, building with the community and not only just for them, as I said. So our design substitute barriers for boundaries. The idea of shifting spatial perception. So public space interventions designed to involve users in creative ways that free space from preconceptions, uncover resources, and fuel common purpose into disarticulated groups. So let's be unafraid to implement ephemeral to permanent strategies to pilot new solutions. So I start with these pieces in equilibrium that were done for an exhibition, just to recall again that we are very interested in doing exhibitions and how these ideas permeate our own projects. So we were asked in this exhibition to see something about the city, see something about the daily life, what happens in daily life cities, and work with an artisan, with a carpenter, with somebody that works in the construction sites, and create a piece in collaboration with them. So the exhibition was called Nothing, Nada Sobra, Nothing is Left. And there was not at all, no budget at all. So we decided to work with what we had on the construction sites of our projects. And we, in Mexico, we always work with these beam woods that we call polines in Spanish. And these beam woods are used for everything in the construction sites. They are very low cost. They use it and reuse it all the time. They just hammer it and unhammer it and put it in different ways. So they can be used as stairs, as balconies, as for cementation, for everything they're used. Not cementation, it's called la simbra. I don't know the name in English, but they're used for everything in the site. So we said, why don't we just use these same pieces and we just put it in another context, in a different context. And just as a ready-made piece, we go and take them into the museum. And so these pieces that were used inside, we brought them into the museum. They contextualized them, put it in a new context, resignify them, just as simple as that. And they became these beautiful pieces, abstract pieces in the site. But not only that, the idea was that how can we use these beamworks for our projects? And so we started with this housing that it's in San Mateo del Mar in Oaxaca, where it has a lot of floods, it has hurricanes, it has earthquakes, it's in has everything of these natural things that happen in a place. And so we decided to start working with these beams to create their spaces. They wanted a multifunctional space. They live like that because they have everything in separate, in these separate spaces where they put the hammocks to sleep. They wanted them to be very close, to lift it from the ground, and to build it with palapa. So it's a very, very simple construction. They have a lot of light, so they want to be enclosed. And so we use these beams to build this multifunctional space where now they have put everything in here and how they use it. So how can we resignify materials that are very low cost and that can serve as a different purpose? In this other dwelling, Oculian, we work with the earthquake that happened in 2017. We usually work in these projects pro bono. So this is why we also do this other private project, because these projects were done pro bono for the people that suffer with the earthquakes of 2017 in Mexico. But we also like to work with small projects. They have taught us that to subvert the logic of architectural production, we shift our perception by making small matter. So it doesn't, we don't mind scale. We believe that small really matters, and how do you do it? So this was the house that we did for Reina. Reina is a single mother with two small kids. There has been a lot of reconstruction for the earthquake that I said happened in 2017 with Piensa Sostenible, that are groups that are thinking sustainable, and they're doing more than 50 houses here in Oculian with different architects. So we went and visited Reina, and all of her things were already outside. And she couldn't believe she was going to have a new house. She before had a house with no windows, with no toilet inside, with, as you can imagine, in terrible conditions. And she had just this small plot where we built the house. Here I go again. So she had that area. And so we decided to go up. We had to use these eco blocks. And then we, as we had very small space, we put an attic to give more speciality. So our design recovers and reinterprets the raised granary platform space and the external hearth of the traditional rural house. The house achieves a thermal interior thanks to the use of eco blocks, walls, and wood. All the wooden elements are used, as I said before, for construction wood scaffolding. But we use them here for the roof, and it became a really interesting roof with these beams that are always used, as I said, for the construction, and the word I forgot before was scaffolding. So she also has an external kitchen. And we work with a mixed-use design for its economy. So it is very economic, it's highly effective, and increases the value of the original property while improving the daily well-being, the social environment, and economic opportunities of the family as a whole. The house has become enormously popular. Many people that walk there take pictures, and one of the most important things, and for me was the learning, was that Caleb, Reina's son, was very, very proud of his home. He takes his shoes to go up to his room, saying that to his mom that he will always take care of his place, that he cannot believe that now he has a home and he invites all his friends. So how does a tiny home such as this make small matter? First, the plight of destruction and human misery framing its construction made us work really fast. Catastrophes are so demanding that their timeframes offer an opportunity to work intuitively and efficiently. Second, we turn to local construction practices that have meaning and resonance with the family's context, and adapted them to maximum budgetary constraints and available materials. So this small house shows how traditional can be modern, vernacular can be innovative. And third, small matters because it's a good way to prototype solutions in a model scale that can be taken to a larger scale. So here we are, and this image was taken, so we did this project in 2018. And this image, they just sent it to me. It was taken like a month ago. And this is how Reina is keeping her house today. So as you can see, it's still the same. It has put all these plants. It looks beautiful. And for me, it was a really, really important lesson to see how Caleb, his son, now will grow with a different sense of place, a different sense of how can space can become a place, and how can beauty become a basic right. So beauty in the meaning of having spatiality, having materiality, having cross ventilation, having a toilet inside the house, having windows, having decent materials for your house. So this is how change begins with a shift of perception. And the idea of approach the landscape as the program. So derelict, underused, or disused urban space, when approached as topography, reveals its natural potential. Unclaimed urban spaces can become ecotones, places of resilience, inclusive, and rich in function diversity. recycling and resignifying extant infrastructure transforms an urban scar or hostile border of the landscape into an attractive horizon. So this next project is Fresnillo Playground. This is a housing unit of 102 buildings in Fresnillo, in Zacatecas, in the northern part of Mexico. It is one of the most violence-ridden municipalities of the region. The housing unit is constantly hogged by members of organized crimes, protecting their territorial influence from other cartels. So the social landscape is intrinsically violent. Every family has somebody disappeared or killed in this area. So besides the social scars inflicted upon the young people growing up in this unit setting, the housing complex had a visible urban scar. Although the canal was a well-flanked delimited space, it was fragmented and inaccessible to many people and difficult to cross due to poor bridge infrastructure. So this exacerbated the problem of disconnection and division. So imagine to cross, you had to go to cross with a wheelchair or a stroll, you had to go down and then go up. And you couldn't cross the canal through all the way because the bridge was there. And so everything was empty. It had really aggressive colors. And but we observed that the children liked to slide through rain gutters that were there. And some teens and adults were playing in some areas that were found. But generally, it was a very unwelcoming place to be there with no shade at all, no trees. So we prompted a workshop approach to help people voice their needs and to understand what they wanted. So again, we work with the community, not just for it. They tell us what they need, but we have the vision to give them more, to read under the things that they say, because they always say very normal things, very common things like paint my house, change the light bulb, put child games. But we read under the lines and doing these queries, these map queries that are more qualitative than quantitative. So we ask them questions that relate more with the experience than with the data. So telling them, where did you give your first kiss in this place? Where did you smoke your first cigarette? Where do you go with your friends to play hide and seek? So the people can relate and perceive the place in a different way. So our main tactic was transforming the urban scar or hostile border, as I said before, of the landscape into an attractive horizon so people would feel drawn to. We made universal accessible bridge that opened an esplanade underneath and rebuilt the canal slopes to make them work as a resting area, agora steps and games. And as a part of a playground program of climbing walls where rain gutters were signified as slides. So we built this bridge where you can cross, where you can go underneath. That is, again, more than a bridge. It gives a lot of shade. It has games underneath. And we already had the slopes. So we put slides and stairs. Stairs became also games. Games not only for kids, but also with lights and shadows. We painted on the floor different games. We planted trees. But one of the most important things, this was before, was, the most dramatic change was merely by color. We changed the original shrill, aggressive colors on the buildings to an earthen palette that made them more welcoming on the human scale and blended them better with the natural soils of the area. So residents felt like they had moved to a different place, not having moved at all. Color gave them a sense of fresh start and made them feel at home. So when derelict, underused, or disused urban space is approached as a natural topography, an unclaimed characteristic of territory can become resignified as a place with character that renegotiates the social tensions of a given environment. Unclaimed urban spaces can be transformed into inclusive places, rich in function diversity. Resignifying an urban scar in the landscape as an attractive horizon has triggered a process of social interaction that is transforming the core identity of the community. So if the landscape can be framed and approached differently, so can the problems assailing the community. You hear it now?
Yes.
Perfect. Sorry. So much better with music. So the other idea, resignify materials. So textures and atmospheres are essential in creating a sense of place. Readings of vernacular or industrial materials, which become sensitive to notions of habitability through patterns, rhythms, colors, surfaces, and shapes, are an invitation not only to look closer, but to come closer together. Make the most out of each material, imprint new meaning to brick and mortar by adding texture to life. So we designed and built the incinerating stations, which houses the furnaces for solid waste combustion in 17 Mexican national ports and airports. Our research for the prototype sought out the most functional form and construction material. So we drew all the elements that had to be inside the station, added the incinerating machine, and realized that a circular plant was the best way to do it. This enclosing spatial arrangement efficiently deployed the operator's program around the incinerating machine. Besides making tasks orderly, it radically transformed the way these facilities used to operate. Finding an adequate name for the project was integral to the conceptual design process. The term station evokes the replicability and tidiness of a space lab and the logistical movement around a train station. And we weren't that far off the mark because some of these stations actually seem to have landed in an alien or post-apocalyptic landscape. We took into account corrosion, extreme temperature, security, exportability, and user comfort. So the main challenge was that the client wanted ready-made parts, as in a prefabricated home, which would adapt to a wide range of climates, a jungle, a desert. So the walls and roof of the station can be set up in a couple of days. For this, we had to create a unique type of folded concrete that is durable, malleable, and requires nearly no maintenance. Although already made, the prototype was flexible enough to become adjusted and improved depending on site-specific conditions. The station became an inhabitable machine that in its round arrangement not only houses an agreeable workspace, but creates a meaningful relationship between the operator and his work. So this is the machine. Another idea of resignifying or looking through new materials was a project we did called From the Territory to the Dwelling. So here we work in a prototype of a house in a very warm weather also with bamboo and recycled polyaluminium roofs. So everything was done with bamboo. We put an with very, very low cost budgets. This is how we ended up. They always do everything outside their houses. So we, as you can see in this image, it looks like a typical portico house from the places that in Morelos, where it is going to be prototype. We did this prototype before in another place, but we are doing it in Morelos now where it's supposed to be. So in this very hot weather, as I said, it's a portico houses are very common. But what we did here was that it's not only one floor house, but it has a second floor that we put in with the same budget. So this was very interesting because people sleep in hammocks outside and you can close in the future this space to be closed and open. Producing or resignifying these materials with very economic and instead of metal roof, it's a polyaluminium recycle that it absorbs the hot weather so it doesn't really get hot inside and it doesn't sound as also all the metal roofs that have when it rains, it has a lot of sound. So it's a very good material and it's very low cost and it's a recycled material. So this is the house from the territory to a dwelling. And we also like to work with local materials. So for this house, for our, it's a weekend house, we also care of details and materiality meets with congruence the identity of a place. So we built this house with the Tescal stone, that is a local stone from the site. So in this private weekend house home, it's a 2-hour drive from Mexico City. The local construction materials to modulate different environments were produced in site. So as you can see, almost all the projects that we do try to be very congruent with the materiality that we use, using local materials, creating an identity of the site. As I said before, looking content in context for us, for me, is very important. So for this house, the main challenge was giving a sense of amplitude and variation in a rather small terrain, so that each space offers something singular. So the place can be experienced as a ground terrace with a luscious garden. And so we create these enclosures and openings. So when you enter through this patio. It's a small house, but it looks bigger as for its openings. So the boundaries between open spaces and enclosures conflict. The house subtly appeals to the user's perception. The emphasis is in hues and textures. So here is closed and then you can open it completely. And if you close it, you have different environments. If you open it, you can look all through the, up to the garden and the pool. So there's extraordinary craftsmanship in the use of materials. The vernacular stone in floors and walls not only project a sense of warmth, but also connect the house to the lands pre-Columbian past and the multiple layers of the Mexican territories. So it is a modern contemporary house, but I think its timeless design nevertheless gives a sense of history and connectedness. Its variety of atmospheres is achieved with different heights using large windows and sliding doors. At times you cannot really tell if you're inside or are outside. So despite its austere design, the home's crafted combination of materials gives an air of fulfillment. So materiality is not solely about form or function, but about place. Materials imprint meaning and nourish well-being to our daily habits. The clients have felt at home in a such way that they're considering moving to their weekend house to inhabit it more permanently. Work with vision. Spatial design that considers urban and social mobility recycles and resignifies buildings according to user routines and thinks of programs flexible enough to harbor different segments of the population throughout the day, enabling people to dwell in a resilient present. So we work with vision in this project called Metropolis. This is a very important project for the office, even though it has not been built. We started this project in 2008 and we continue working on the project. So as I said before, constructing millions of homes far from city centers has generated a series of problems of inequality because of mobility. In Mexico City, people spend on average 2 to 3 hours daily in commuting and close to 30% of their income in transportation. So the less money people have, the more time they give up. As I showed you before, this type of housing far away from transportation centers. So people throw away life getting places. Among Mexico City's greatest assets is its transit system. It services closest to 70% of the population. So why not make the most out of it? Metropolis. It recycles 22 buildings in 16 stations connected to the subway network. It enhances the urban transportation system as a network of networks. The iconic facade of these buildings built in the 70s makes them ideal for multi-service centers. Some of them are derelict or underused buildings. So this was an idea that came out for a magazine. They invited us to do an urban project in a magazine. We were not paid. And they said, you can do whatever you want, but you have to recycle something. You cannot start a building from zero. So I gave the task at the office that for the weekend they would go and take photographs of all the derelict or underused buildings they can see in the city. There are many, many buildings like that. And when we came back on Monday to the office and we put all the photographs that were taken during the weekend, one of these buildings showed up. And then another of these buildings show up, taken by two different persons in two different sites. So we were curious about it. And we started discovering that in Mexico City, in the lines in the subway stations 1, 2, and 3, there are 22 buildings exactly the same. And we all know that there are these buildings, iconic buildings, as I said, because of the facade. We all know them. We know that they are on top of the subway stations, but most of the people in Mexico don't know that there are 22 buildings the same. We know there are 4, 5, but 22. So imagine what could happen with 22 underused buildings, because some of these buildings have only two people working on a floor. Some are completely empty. Some have changed their uses, but none of them are in completely use. So imagine in any part of the world, this would be pure gold to do something. and nobody has paid attention to them. So the idea was transforming these buildings into a network of networks, creating social program, different program in each floor. So imagine this connection and having different programs. So this is how they were seen. This is how the subway is every day in Mexico. And informal commerce daily brings into subway wagons all kinds of products, from music to sewing kits. So would it be possible to fit in also a health clinic, a concert hall, a supermarket, a sports center, kindergarten on a regular basis? So we articulated them and generated an underground loop of entertainment, arts, sports, commerce, and health that meets the user transportation routines. So on the underground, you will go all the time, you will go up in each building, and we will create a city under the city. And not only that, we thought, well, with this idea, we went with the government. Everybody knows the project, they really like it, but it's very difficult with it, all these bureaucratic problems to be done. So the project was left there, and recently we were invited to an exhibition, again talking about exhibitions, that was called Utopia. And they asked us for a utopic project. So I decided again to work with the with these buildings. And so what we did was that we put playful program in each building, recovering a historical utopic sense of place from the subway station name, that way that they were located. So the program's archaeology of the name interconnects the roots of our historic subsoil. So, for example, Juanacatlan, that means the place for butterflies. So we created in this place for the butterflies. And Pino Suarez has already this archaeological site that became a playground. And Tacuba, it's the place of flowers. So we created this place of flowers. So also thinking about these new visions of the place, taking its original name and now drawing these ideas of the project of each station becoming the name, but not how do I say? So now the name has become a project. Salto del agua, jumping to the water. So, so this idea of negotiating with all the government and doing doesn't avoid us of creating a new sense of each project. And so we have been working and we will continue working in this project in different ways, because we believe that it's a very interesting project for the city. So this will give the city a new vision of what underused buildings can be used for. And hold beauty as a basic right. So beautiful design is an investment in dignity. Regardless of budgetary constraints, beauty is affordable by a virtuous use of resources. Elegant solutions are intrinsic to the program. Buildings are infrastructure for new ecologies. So we need to approach every space with the same respect we have for sacred spaces. Aesthetic decisions can become infrastructure that changes people's lives. So for me, more than following a line of design, the challenge is to make the line a vision, a vector, a force. When we activate that vision, we organize, we mobilize, we generate change. So we interact through boundaries, we integrate opportunity, we involve everyone's presence. This is for me the way of looking with a new and creative vision. Thank you very much.